Good afternoon, and welcome to Art Basel Miami Beach Salon Talk. This next talk is called Public Art Fieldwork, moderated by Nicolás, who is a curator of Art Basel's public sector. Thank you. And director and chief curator of Public Art Fund in New York. And for the artists, I would like to introduce Ryan Gander from London, Liz Glynn from Los Angeles, and Nico Goldberg from Buenos Aires.
Mary, thank you for that loquacious introduction. It's always a pleasure to work with colleagues of whom I'm so fond, and thanks for joining us for this discussion. This is the second year that Art Basel has invited me to curate the public section of the fair. My sort of day job is as director and chief curator of the Public Art Fund in New York, and of course December in New York is not a great time to be opening public art exhibitions. It's a little chilly there, so really nice to have the chance to do something here in Miami. And especially interesting for me because it's a chance to work with artists that I know and love and have worked with before, like Ryan Gander, and also to get to know better artists who I've already sort of been in conversation with, like Liz, and artists who I hadn't met before and I'm just having the chance to really sort of get to know and work with for the first time, like Nicolás. There are 26 artists in the public section this year, as well as four performances that were commissioned for the opening events. So I think it's a kind of total of 30 projects, even more artists because some are kind of duo participants. So it's really grown into a really vibrant, active part of the overall fair program, I think. For me, it was an interesting challenge. My own background is as a museum curator, and I've been at Public Art Fund doing outdoor projects there for the last 5.5 years. And I really didn't know what it would be like to curate within an art fair context. Because in a way, an art fair seems almost like the opposite of what a curated project would be like. An art fair is this almost kind of, self-organizing system that just emerges, that has all of these sort of disparate galleries from all over the world. Things come together. Of course, there's a system and an organization, but within that, there's a kind of profusion and chaos and density, and that can be exciting and interesting and lead to seeing things that you would never have kind of come across or imagined going together. But it can also be kind of disorienting and overwhelming and chaotic. So for me, it was kind of an interesting challenge just to think how I would bring my own kind of curatorial perspective to that context. And fortunately, we have a beautiful location, Collins Park, in front of the Bass Museum, which offers a really nice range of sites. There's the sort of grand central space that leads from the beach and Collins Ave to the front of the museum. There are the pathways that kind of lead around to the sides where you have some really wonderful mature trees. The baobab trees are especially sort of sculptural and voluptuous. So there's something really appealing about that space. I love the Bass Museum sort of with its facade of the kind of fossilized coral. It has a sense of nature and the abundance of nature that is very different to working on the streets of New York City. So So that's actually interesting as well. And we can maybe talk more as we get into a conversation about the projects that each of these artists have done, about what it's like, what's different about working in an art fair context versus working in a, you know, a gallery or museum context. But I wanted to have some kind of framing device, even within the fact that it's by nature going to be a very diverse group of artists and group of works, because it is part of the art fair. So all of the galleries that participate in the fair are eligible to apply to be in the sector, and then I get to sort of choose which projects to move forward with. And of course, there are a lot of background conversations happening before that with artists and with galleries about the kinds of projects that could work. So, I see that my security has arrived. That makes me feel much better. We've actually just been joined by we've just been joined by one of Ryan Gander's works of art, also known as Fernandez. He's actually half of the performance piece that Ryan conceived for the opening events, which, well, Ryan, really, you should say what the piece is.
Hello. Did you know he was going to be here?
No.
Is this just by chance that you're here?
Well, no.
Yeah. Because a very funny thing happened the other day. Nicolás met Fernandez on the Gagosian stand when you were looking after a very famous person. It was Leonardo DiCaprio. But I should go back to the beginning. Nicolás asked if I wanted to do a performance, and we had to talk about some ideas, and one of the ideas was that he would have bodyguards, and it was his least favourite idea, obviously, because it involved him being slightly embarrassed. But then it was the one that happened.
Because I can't say no to Ryan Gander. I mean, you know.
But it's quite interesting. It was one of those works that was like, I didn't know if it would be good or not, which I always think's a good judge of an artwork. If I'm going to make a work and I know it's going to be amazing, it's not very exciting. And the whole point of art is that, you know, you learn from it, and half the stuff you make is shit and you put it in the bin. If you always make genius works, you're not really an artist, you're just somebody who makes genius works. So it could have been a one-liner and it could have been terrible, or it could have ended up being really light on its feet and a really beautiful, simple gesture. But I didn't actually know, so it was a bit of a chance investigation. And I think it ended up being really interesting. Well, I learned a lot from it, so. About these currencies of visibility you get with stardom, like people taking photographs with flashes. Whenever that happens, the sort of spectacle and the spectator change roles. And there's always a buzz about it. Everyone gets very excited when they see bodyguards. Because who are they protecting? They must be very important. So it was playing in that sort of language, those languages of validation or importance through association. How did you feel?
Yeah, no, exactly. And I mean, just to bring it back to the kind of introduction about the notion framing the exhibition this year being fieldwork, in a way, I think Ryan's approach to this illustrates exactly kind of what I thought would be interesting, that that it suggests a notion of process where artists are engaged in a kind of research and development and experimentation, and taking their work from the studio or from a gallery setting and thinking about how it actually would work in public, in outdoor space, in the context of an art fair, is kind of taking their work into the field, verifying their ideas and seeing how that works. So this performance piece really was kind of a great example of of how that happened. And I think Liz's piece, you know, was the same. I also was wanting to have a kind of framing device that also spoke about the audience as much as it did about the work in the exhibition. And I also feel like for all of you and all of us that come to Miami for this, in a sense, we're doing our field work. You know, collectors are hoping to make, you know, a discovery, a find. Curators are sort of getting out of their museums and away from their computers and actually, you know, seeing work and looking at how it functions in the real world. So those were kind of the broad ideas that came together to frame the exhibition. And then beyond that, you know, it's been this sort of lovely series of surprises, like Ryan's piece, like Liz's piece, discovering and seeing the works here. Nico's piece had only been shown once before in a very different context. I'll let him talk about that. But the pleasure for me, of course, is seeing all of those surprises kind of happen and then seeing people interact and relate. So with that, perhaps, you know, I'll ask each of the artists to just give a kind of quick introduction and talk a little bit about their piece, and then we can sort of delve further into some of the themes. So, Nico, would you like to go?
Yeah, sure. Well, first, thank you for the invitation. Maybe I could speak a little bit about what the project that I've been doing for the last 9 years with Guillermo Fajovic. We're a duo from Argentina, and we've been basically producing a intense and in-depth research-based project on a cosmic event, on a meteorite fall that happened about 4,000 years ago in northern Argentina, where an 800-ton asteroid was entering the atmosphere and it shattered into many, many pieces and it scattered a very large area. And since the time of the fall of these masses of iron, which come from the asteroid belt, they've been visited by mankind. And they've been seen in many different manners. And we've been basically, the project started in 2006, and we've been basically kind of remapping the narratives and the histories of some of these masses, developing different types of projects, all mainly research-based. In 2012, when we were commissioned for Documenta, we came up with this idea, this premise, to try and move the largest mass that was lying in this crater field, which was 37 tons big, the second largest meteorite on Earth. And for 2.5 years, we worked very hard with very complex institutional engineering to make this happen, involving government agencies on many levels. And we had to cancel it in the end because a very complex situation came up. In short, basically sort of a poetic gesture of moving this extraterrestrial mass from this site to Castle for 100 days became a political thing. So we kind of saw that unravel, and we put ourselves in retreat and observed all of the incredible things that happened during those months prior to Documenta. So when we canceled the project, we had to more or less decide what to do in the exhibition. And we were very interested in weight. So we came up with this idea of producing a series of iron works. These meteorites are iron, and we are very much driven towards the sort of the gravity of these masses. So we decided to take from from what we were researching, and open up a series of sculptures that add up to the weight of this meteorite that never moved. So this work that we are presenting here is the third sort of installment in this series of works. The first one was presented at Friedrichplatz. There are all 3.6 ton works of iron masses. And in this case, we rendered the contour of the province where this meteorite rain occurred 4,000 years ago. And in a way, we were very interested in trying to create like a series of works that could address more or less what happened during those 2 years and a half that we were working to move this gigantic mass to Kassel. So it's more or less of a semiotic game, maybe, in a series.
It was interesting hearing you talk about mass, because the project I did with the artist Don Casper, who is not here today, was called Cosmo Illogical, and it's sort of an irrational planetarium show that was presented on Tuesday and Wednesday nights inside a geodesic dome with these projected drawings and a floor that kind of becomes activated as a drawing surface. One of the things we were interested in with the project was kind of looking at the difference between the beauty of theoretical structures and the sort of like messy reality of dealing with mass in the universe, and how that functions. I work also as a sculptor, but I'm kind of interested in how events shape history and shape how events are reflected in our material world. For me, what was interesting was in the collaboration with Don, who's an artist that I've known and kind of bounced off of in LA for maybe the last 5 years or so. We'd never worked really closely together, and became very aware of some of the assumptions in my own practice and how difficult it was to develop the collaboration, as the performance is structured in that I'm meant to embody matter and she embodies antimatter, and in physics, when matter and antimatter collide, they destroy each other. And so in the performance, my role is to kind of embody and describe these theories, whereas she sort of inhabits a space through these bodies of sound, and it creates this sort of dynamic where even the experiment at the end that's meant to prove the physics model falls apart. So for me, the idea of doing something at Basel for public was also about creating sort of a space outside of the fair, but that was kind of maybe thinking about a shift in perspectival position and giving members of the audience a chance to sort of step out of the bright white lights of the art fair and kind of think about their relative position in the universe. So.
Hello.
Is the pictures of mine? Essentially, mine's a US aid parcel. Do you know what they look like? They're like, it's four barrels on a parachute, and the US, well, lots of countries drop aid into urgent situations. And it's stuck in the tree. So it's four barrels that are on a parachute stuck in the branches of a tree. It's called it's one of about 60 sculptures, a series of sculptures that I've made, which are called alchemy boxes. And they're essentially a bit like, that's it, that's what it looks like. They're essentially like time capsules or toolkits that contain lots of objects that I would use in the construction of an artwork. And then with each of these alchemy boxes, and they all look different. The one alchemy box is a pile of magazines that has a cavity in the center where everything's hidden. Another one is a blanket. Another one is a concrete bollard. So they always look totally different, and they always look a bit like a cliche of what art might look like. So they're a bit like cartoon artworks. And the thing that's around, because this looks a bit like a cartoon artwork as well. It's like, it's made to look a bit like art. So essentially the thing that's inside is the most important thing. That's its soul, and that's its heart, and that's where all the conceptual rigor is. And the thing that is the vessel that contains it, or the container, is just like a pastiche of art. And you don't know, well, you have to obviously trust that the things are inside. If you opened it, you'd destroy the artwork to get to the art. And with each of them, there's a text, sometimes on the wall, sometimes handwritten on a note on the floor. And with this one, it's a stainless steel etched plate in a concrete setting in the floor. And that lists all the items that are inside. And each of the alchemy boxes are on a subject. And this one is on the subject of the eloquent and the gaga. And it's about the failures of artists to speak fluently in visual language over the last 5 or 6 years. So I use the word gaga for artists who aren't fluent in visual language. Because if you think of, you know, if you learned like Russian for 20 years, you'd be pretty proficient in Russian. And that's my goal, is to be very proficient in visual language and have great intonation and be very articulate.
Hello?
Hello. Very articulate. And if you look at a lot of signifiers that are used in contemporary art recently, the diamond, the skull, the palm tree, smiley faces, emoticons, all these things. They, if you translated those into spoken language from visual language, it would be like gaga, mama, dada, because they're all very basic signifiers. They're all, you know, very simplified caricatures of visual language. So all the things inside are related to that idea of trying to articulate that.
It's interesting to hear these three very different artists, very, you know, from different places, at different stages in their careers as well, but also how even in this kind of sample of three, there are very interesting correspondences. I love the fact that somehow gravity is a sort of very active motif in each one of the pieces that was presented. So there's something about this kind of a questioning and addressing of the nature of matter itself, and sort of weight and gravity and matter colliding. So, you know, really interesting that there are those kinds of synergies that emerge. But I'm also curious to ask you guys. There's a lot of, you know, talk about post-internet art, for example. Now,
what is that?
No, we're not. No, but what? Don't worry, your head's not going to explode. But I was thinking, what about, you know, post-art fair art? Because it strikes me that, you know, you guys are all artists who've been sort of exhibiting professionally during the sort of ascendancy of the art fair. That's been a big part of the art world, you know, in the last 15 years as you've sort of developed and matured as artists. So I guess that's, in a way, what I wanted to ask is what is different to you about presenting your work in this context, or, you know, what's appealing about it? Does it strike you as different to another kind of context generically, or not? Liz touched on it a little bit already in her answer, I guess, but I'm sort of curious.
Well, in in our case, I think since we've begun working on our project, the institutional realm, you know, slash gallery slash art fair, we've always tried to find these things as enablers, really. And our work is a lot about process and trying to find a way to make things kind of make sense for us when these invitations maybe occur, like a commission or an invitation to a fair. I could say in the context of this fair, for our project, it's been an opportunity, for instance, to show a meteorite that has been hiding inside of the home of an American geologist since the 1960s, and someone who is a dear friend of ours now, after many years of work, and we decided to
it's here in the fair.
We thought it was a good opportunity to get it out of his house, maybe, and that posed the question of basically just coming to him and saying, "Can you lend us your meteorite, which is 130 pounds?" and from this fall, from Campo del Cielo. And he agreed to it. He's about 90 years old. And he actually wrote an email some days later and said, "You know what, I'm gonna actually give it to you so you can have it from now on. I've had it for over 40 years and nobody's seeing it, so I would love this meteorite to be seen." And we were extremely flattered and had to sort of build the situation of the meteorite to be driven down from Pittsburgh to Miami. And the only condition was that it could not be for sale. So that was nice. I mean, to be able to bring down a meteorite that's not for sale in a place where basically everything is for sale, that creates a little of a minor narrative within our own project and the way we like to work with what we do.
But in a sense, you're obviously sort of touching on this fact of visibility and what an art fair offers, you know, what Art Basel Miami offers in a sense is a very concentrated focus of attention from the art world and even the sort of the broader media, perhaps, as the art fair has kind of ballooned into a cultural sort of festival of sorts or event. So it does strike me that a lot of the things that we present get a level of attention and have the potential to have a level of impact that would be hard to achieve, you know, in another kind of context. I don't know. Other thoughts? Liz, Ryan?
I think for me, I'm less interested in maybe the possibility of attention and more the potential for intimacy in something that's so massive that tens of thousands of people visit. And especially on a day like today, people are walking through almost kind of in this herd mentality. And I think, I guess going to your question of context, I feel like I've done other projects in the past. Last year I did a piece for Freeze New York that was called The Vault, that where only a select but completely random group of people could come in and had a very direct interaction with a performer as a clerk who would make them a drink and activate a set of objects and tell them a story based on the objects contained in the vault. And that project was very much kind of about how we attach meaning and value to physical things. But I also think having done some work like that, that it also isn't maybe the only role for an artist, particularly someone working with events, to have to be the one to provide the context or the kind of critical position relative to a setting like the art fair. And I feel like this collaboration with Don was sort of another option.
I've forgotten the question. Something about art fairs.
Yeah, you know, are you a post-art fair artist, right?
Post-internet, post-art fair, post-most things. Actually, I wish I'd known what the art world was like before art fairs. I haven't got a clue. It's hard for me to know to compare it to anything, because I'm that generation that I went to the first freeze, you know? So.
Yeah.
Am I paced? I don't know.
Yeah, well, I...
It's nice to be able... It's just a different context, isn't it? It's nice to be able to be invited by you, because it means that I can do whatever I want. It's like dream invitation, because I've done a lot of public art things and they never get accepted, and the ones that do get accepted end really badly. The ones I've done with him always end really well, and it's something to do with trust and intelligence, I think, because most public art things have people involved in the selection or the realization that don't know anything about art. They're like town councillors, or they're like money people from a board, or and they just sort of get in the way. And I'd never go to my doctor and say, I've got a headache, can you just drill a hole here? Because I didn't study medicine. But that never sort of equates to being an artist. Everybody thinks they, because everyone has taste, everyone thinks they can chip in and stir the pot. Trust your doctor is my advice. I don't know.
But you also have to have a gallery that says yes.
Yeah, I like his gallery that said yes to something that wasn't for sale. Amazing.
Thank you.
That sounds good. I like that there's this phenomenon, and I like that it's a meteorite, like it's landed here, this total phenomenal object, but with a phenomenal structuring around it to do with its like economics. It's really interesting. It's like one of a kind in this whole art fair, where everything looks quite similar anyway, and then there's this thing that just stands apart, not because the way it looks, but because of what it is. That's great.
So I see Fernandez is still here. So I just to bring him into the conversation as well, since getting to know Fernandez and his partner in bodyguarding, William. Where's William? Yeah, please join us up.
Everyone, is this on? Good evening, everyone. I'm Fernandez Donaldson. I'm the security officer and bodyguard for just about everyone. But anyway, what do you guys want me to say about that affair? Except that it was outstanding.
How was it for you? I think the key thing was when Nicolás and I spoke about it, we were talking about how people would act if they were a bodyguard. But then I was like, well, we don't need an actor. We should just get a bodyguard, because they'll know what to do. Makes perfect sense. But because you knew the situation, you knew it was associated with a contemporary art performance, were you acting? That was my big question. Did you fit? I saw you like looking around on the top of buildings for snipers, but you knew there was no snipers there. So how much of it was fictional behavior? That was my question.
Yeah, okay, let me, that's very good. You got me on that one. Basically, we wanted the audience to look at the fact as if something was going on. The thing is, it did catch their attention, because we would perpetrate someone's up on a roof. Maybe there's a sniper on a roof. Maybe there's someone in a tree. Maybe there's someone trying to take something, taking it from point A to point B. And even though the speaker was speaking, we still had to focus on the one person who we're being the bodyguard for. Also focus that we have to take control of the situation that's going around us. And also take in mind that we also have to take focus on everything that's basically there, all the artwork that's there. We have to make sure it's all secured in the same area. And also the people that are in that surrounding area. And to watch the results of that, because the whole thing was perpetrated. None of it was real. None of it was going on. But to watch the audience's reaction was amazing. And to keep a straight face is very hard to do. Because I was on a radio with my supervisor, who is Will, who's not here right now. who is constantly like, Fernandez, do not crack up, because we will be looking at the audience's reaction. They're looking up to see what we're pointing at. We have our guards running from point A to point B within the vicinity of the area, and they're watching this, and nothing's really going on. And honestly, it was kind of amazing because it was like a work of art to watch it going on.
Was he a difficult client? Was he very demanding? Because curators can be trouble, you know.
To be quite honest with you, he is such a gentleman. I mean, this man is, seriously, he knows exactly where everything belongs and how it should act. It's amazing. I saw it at the beginning when he first started, but once it was completed, I was like, this place is phenomenal. I mean, it was incredible how everything was set. Every piece was facing just the direction when you walked in to where it was like aligned perfectly to how you could look at something. And there's one, your piece that you have with the barrels, even though I was scared to stand under them, to be honest with you, I didn't know what was in them. I love that piece.
He's scared.
Buddy.
It must be really scary. Piece.
No, we were just wondering what was in them because no one knew what was in there. So I'm going like, okay, I can see the parachute. I can see the three barrels. I can see it looks like something to where, you know, something's falling out of the sky. It looks like maybe there's four kits or maybe saving, life-saving kits or whatever in there.
It's got, it makes sense. Do you want to know what's in it? I think it's got stones from graves of my family and a collection of mints, British mints, all different shapes, and a scratch card, lottery ticket, that's not been scratched, so it could be worth a lot of money.
You never
Things
know.
Like that, just junk, really, not
okay.
Not a lot.
I had a kind of a really nice experience with your piece, because like Nicolás mentioned before, we hadn't met. So I met him during installation on Monday, and he was just by himself with his glasses and his shades and a little like hat. We were like, "Hi, how are you?" And that was it. And I came back for the opening. And when I got to the opening, and this is also, I must say, this is the first time I'm in a Art Basel. So I was like, okay. And I went to the opening, and I saw him in the middle of the crowd. And it was pretty dark, so I couldn't really tell. It was full of people. And when I approached him, these two guys just came in front and locked down the situation, like put hands on me. And I thought, what the hell's going here? Like, Art Basel, are they putting like bodyguards on curators? Are they in danger? You know, are some artists that didn't get into public gonna kill him? Or so it was fun. Then somebody explained. So, but it was nice. Yeah.
I think the work is people's reaction. It's not the actual thing. It's like the. I think maybe that's a good thing about public is most of the works function in storytelling and fable making. So it's not the actual things. It's not like physical stuff. It's people sitting in a bar talking about it in Madrid in 2 months' time. That's the kind of currency. It's almost like the things are just offcuts or byproducts, and the stories about these things are the, where a lot of stuff inside the fair doesn't feel like that. They're tangible things. That's the difference.
Well, and your work is so much, you know, if you think of the parachute dropping, I mean, it's all a fable. It's all playing with that line between sort of fiction and suggestion and trust on all of those levels. So I know, should we have some questions?
Sure, why Mary? Not? Yeah, I mean, I just have a practical question for Ryan. This work I know is made specifically for Nicolás. Could it exist another time where another person would be guarded, and would that work?
I've had three curators ask if they can have it. Seriously, I got an email from Montreal this morning from a curator who said he wanted it. It's the egos of curators, they love it. I think it just seemed to fit. It fits Miami. I don't know if it would fit like Montreal, It doesn't work there, does it? Because you don't have P. Diddy walking around with bodyguards, so it's not going to have the same kind of ring to it. So maybe it'd work in Las Vegas, but I don't know how many institutions of art there are in Las Vegas. There's got to be some. Yeah. So it's contextually bound here, I think.
Yes.
Hi. First of all, I don't see this artist work when they rotate.
I'm not sure why, but I think there was an image of the work maybe inside of a gallery space at some point. I've seen it.
You saw it?
Good thing is you can walk to it now.
Also. Oh, okay. So it's not outside.
Yes, it's outside.
Oh.
It's outside here, okay. Outside the bath.
Yeah, so it's a little difficult for... Anyway, I just wondering the what, like you said, was a post, this one?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. There was outside too, right? Okay. So the question was, as an artist, I'm an artist too. I do lots of permanent public art. So I was wondering what those art will be, like a post-exhibition, what those public art will be.
Well, actually, one of the really nice things about doing the project here is that all of the galleries that are participating are invited to leave the work there in Collins Park through the winter, through March, and the Bass Museum takes over the exhibition, and so it really functions as an exhibition that has a life beyond, you know, the 5 or 6 days of the art fair, which I think is a really lovely thing. Of course, not every work stays, but I think this year a really good proportion of the works will. So that's a really nice thing, but. You know, in general, of course, as a part of the art fair, most of the works are for sale, and you know, the galleries might sell them or might not. That's obviously like anything else in the fair. Any other question? Yeah. Any other questions people might have? Don't be intimidated by my bodyguard. You know, I promise he's really not as tough as he looks.
I just wanted to know how does a contract for the bodyguard works? Like how defined are things? Like how much did you know about it? How much do you have to negotiate? What is Fernando willing to do for you? I want to know.
Well, but is this working?
Yeah.
Okay, you can't hear me. Well, basically, as a bodyguard, our main concern is protection of the person that we're basically protecting. That's a bodyguard's job. It's let's say, hypothetically speaking, if you were my client, the first thing I would ask you is, you know, do you have any medical conditions? Are there any particular hospitals you'd like to be taken care of? Taken to if some kind of emergency came into, you got sick or something. Basically, you know, what type of medication are you on? Are there any medical conditions wrong with you? Make sure everything I know about you, I need to know in case something happens to you. My job is to focus my whole entire being of taking care of you. Of making sure no one gets in your way, how much room do you want and space between you and any other party? And basically, you know, I'm there. I'll be the one who takes the bullet, basically, no matter how you put it.
I've got a question as well.
Wasn't the question
weird,
for him?
Yeah, I think this.
I think the question was
rephrase it.
The extent of his contract. Yeah. Like, what could you ask for?
Now,
did you get paid the same
for protecting Leonardo DiCaprio in the morning as you did for Nicolas in the evening? Because there was no threat. Well, there might have been a threat, but you've not got that many stalkers, have you?
To be honest with you, We basically leave it under the same concept. We will not change that old format at all.
Yeah.
Our protection is basically no one gets through that pathway unless he okays it. If that person does not okay it, you're not coming through. If you're coming into a club, a party, we're basically on, there's one to the right, one to the left. You're not going through, you don't come through without their permission. Our job is basically your protection, your comfort, and that's what we're there for. If there's a problem with it, that's not our problem.
Yeah, as far as the Art Basel, I mean, this the company that Fernandez works for is sort of the security company here working with Art Basel, right?
Right.
Yeah, so I guess it was negotiated sort of within that contract. I'm actually not sure. My sort of colleague Benjamin Grappin probably knows more about how the details of that all worked. Let's just say it was not the most expensive of the artist's performances.
We have one more question.
Okay.
Well, this is a kind of banal question. A kind of banal question, plus a comment. Where is the meteorite? Which gallery?
It's in the position sector.
Ah, very good.
Yeah, it'll be easy to find.
Okay.
But it's in that sector.
Perfect. And the comment I wanted to make was the idea that you were given the meteorite, you become a custodian in the sense that a real collector is a custodian of a work of art, even though you have an implication with it. And it just sort of seemed like an interesting dialectic. For sale, not for sale, collector, owner.
Yeah. There's also another important aspect I like that you use the word custodian. Because I think it'll be probably temporary in terms of that meteorite. First of all, these meteorites that fell in Argentina are currently illegally tradable. Like, you can't trade them. It's illegal for them to leave the province where they fell. It's illegal for them to leave the country. It's absolutely illegal to buy and sell. So, and also, we would never do that. We're not interested in mineral trading, but we are interested in the narrative of the trading in terms of what's going on with these extraterrestrial masses that fell a long, long time ago in Argentina, and we're also very interested in bringing this forward. So, we thought it would be interesting for people to ask if it could be bought, and we instructed the galleries to explain what I just explained. So, bringing the stone to the fair is just like a one stop within some more stops that will occur between the stone being in Pittsburgh and the stone coming back to Argentina.
We might have one more question.
Ryan, you mentioned the Gaga and the visual language. Could you talk a little bit more about that? It sounded like an interesting.
I don't think I should, because I just realized they're filming it. And I might mention people's names, and then everyone will hate me. Visual language is very complex. And in the art world, and not in the art world, there's the art world and the art market. In the art market, things that are easy on the eye and visually very stimulating are also very simple, like very short words that don't have much meaning, singular meaning. And they're used very frequently because they're things that sell more rapidly. It's just basic economics. But it doesn't necessarily make for an interesting, intelligent work of art. And there's the point is that, the mastering of visual language is the essence of art, is the thing that everyone should strive for. to push things forward and to write art history. So it's, I mean, you could write a book on it.
And I think maybe just to sort of close on that notion of visual language, I think one of the valuable things about an art fair, about doing the public art in Collins Park, is that visual language is not something that's really taught in schools. And so when I was in the park this morning, it was mob. There were, you know, student groups, lots of schools, you know, group tours, people just looking. And I think it's a really important thing that that there's this kind of very accessible forum for people who are not professionally involved, are not maybe, you know, don't have the privilege of the kind of access that many of us do, that art that's actually done at a very high level, that isn't just the simplest, most sort of market friendly work, can be presented sympathetically. And I think you can see that the response is generally incredibly positive. And it's been a lot of fun to work with you guys and to meet Fernandez as well. I hope we get the chance to work again in the future. But really, it was tremendous working with you guys, and I appreciate your contribution so much. Thank you guys for coming.